So, I thought I'd just talk a bit about I really don't like talking about it because it makes me feel like I'm whinging and makes me just get in this mindset like, it's not about complaining, but it's like, I don't know if you can hear me, sorry behind. Yeah, and I just want to explain the real physical symptoms that I was experiencing before I left Australia. I've sort of said, I had people in disability services basically being, well, one person being really condescending to me, saying oh, women used to have 10 children, what's wrong with you? You can't even handle one child. And just drink down. I just want to kill it because it's usually when the youngest child is grown up a bit, they start helping with the other children, and by the time the youngest child's born, all the other kids are basically doing all the jobs around the house. I guess with my daughter, I can't leave her unattended at all. She would just destroy things. You might have seen in a couple of videos. I mean, I don't really have stuff to destroy anymore, but she still manages to find something to pull apart or wreck. So actually, I started getting quite bad anxiety. I don't know if it was anxiety as such, or I don't know. I'm actually feeling it now. It's like I can't breathe. I'm trying to take a breath out. Basically, around, I think it's to do with always having to be on constant surveillance, all the time with her, and not being able to just go into your own space and chill out and be able to, for me, it's reintegrate, with your brain and your body, like in meditation and yoga, and but also even how do you say it? Being able to have one's thoughts and one's time to oneself, being a massage therapist, that's what I preach. It's you have to have time to for your body and your mind to for your mind to be able to switch off. So your because we've got two nervous systems, so the no, I was getting confused. I think it's the parasympathetic nervous system. Is the fight or flight, so that's what we're doing most of the time through the day. And then the other nervous system is when we're resting, when we're digesting food, it's like the healing system. So if you're always in fight and flight, then your body doesn't have time to heal and regenerate and be able to cope again with further stresses. And I mean, my daughter, it's been 15 years non-stop. I guess most people know what it's like to be around a toddler and have care of a toddler. You just have to watch them all the time. It's exhausting. And I think after 15 years, and then plus the court case and with her father, trying to get child support and everything, it just pushed me over the edge. I was, the breathing thing, and then I developed this itching in my shoulders. I was just constantly felt this uncontrollable itching sensation, and I just felt like, my God, my nervous system is just breaking down. And hello. Yeah, I just thought, well, what good am I to Freya if I'm in a, what do they call it? If I have a nervous breakdown, and how am I gonna care for her? What good am I to her if I just keep going and end up just fucking losing it? And so, yeah, at that point, my friend, I just rang around the blue and said, "Would you look after Freya for 2 or 3 weeks? I just I think I paid her a grant, like $1,000 a week to look after her, and she really needed the money. It was coming up to Christmas, but anyway. And yeah, so I had time to myself in the Philippines, and yeah, just the sensation of like having one's own space, like not having to get up, not having to turn around every 5 minutes and be like, what's she doing? Like, why can't you just go into this? For me, it's like a balloon, or like, you know, like when you open a bottle of champagne, like just like. And that took, I think, about 2 weeks to really fully feel like I'd come back into my normal state and could actually have a conversation with someone, like actually felt like talking to people, because I think when you're in such a state of stress, like I couldn't even string a sentence together, like with most people, you know, if it wasn't about Frey or work or something, I just had no energy for anything else. So yeah, so I was really at the point of going, well, I basically have to relinquish care of her. Like, through the court case, I tried to ask the father to take, you know, some physical responsibility for her, because, you know, I want to continue my study. I want to be able to have time for myself, you know, have friends again. Like, it's hard to take her anywhere because I just got to watch her all the time. I can't relax with people. I can't have a normal conversation. It's like I'm always on alert. Like, it's... Anyway, wind and whatever. So, yeah, I was like, okay, well, maybe that's the best thing for her. But I just thought, you know, I'm still in a stressed state. I need to go and have time for myself to make sure this is really the right decision, or you know, maybe I'm just having a bad patch or something with her. And yeah, I went to Philippines, and then my friend who I'd met the year before that lives there, like, offered to that his family would help with her care, and asked if I want to move there and stay with them, and his family could help look after her, which, you know, and I was just like, wow, like, no one had ever really offered to help me with her before. I mean, she would go to the respite house up at Atherton, and yeah, I had like 72 nights a year with her up there, and I think, you know, that's the only way I really coped with her, was being able to have, like, you know, a week. It was about a week every month that she went there, or sometimes she'd go for 2 weeks. Yeah, anyway. So, but yeah, it's still hard, like, leaving her in a respite center, like, you know, as much, but it is nice, because when I'm away for her for that long, I can actually come back to normal again, and I can feel, yeah, I just feel more like, I'm always, like, I'll be happy to see her when I go to pick her up, and yeah, it's usually at least 3 or 4 weeks before I start feeling crazy again. But and it was really interesting in Philippines, because it wasn't like there was one person looking after her. Like, I really stepped back. I actually went and got my own place, just, you know, a couple of k's down the road, and the family just helped look after her. But in that family environment, she really, there was so much, like, stimulation for her. There was 3 younger kids, and then my friend's brother and his girlfriend, and then the mum and dad. And yeah, there was always something for her to watch or do or be interested in. And yeah, and they just kind of had it all covered, you know. I mean, it wasn't totally perfect, but it was a great sensory environment and lots of talking and, you know, music and TV and other kids and, yeah, lots of interaction and stuff. And that was really great, because I think when it's just me and her and it's been a long time, like, I can get really exhausted, and, you know, there's no one else in our environment. Like, she's not learning language or something, and I'm not a big talker most of the time. And So yeah, it was really good for her, I think, to be in that kind of environment. And yeah, and then we stayed with another family too, and that's just the general thing I find in Asia, is like the family, feeling of family and family environment. And even if we're like going McDonald's or something like that, and she, sorry, I'm just talking to myself.
Ice coffee!
Yes.
Oh, thank you. Yeah, she'll stop and go up to someone and like go, oh, get a chip off their plate or something. Like, people just see her and they're like, oh, it's okay, it's okay. She's a special child. Whereas, check this stuff out. Yeah, I just never really found that. People have seemed a bit more like freaked out in Australia. But, what was I gonna say, Frey? There's something I wanted to say. Maybe coffee will fix it. Yeah, so I've just found someone to help look after her here. Not really sure what's going on with child support and that sort of stuff. Like, that's how I've been able to live overseas, is just by using the money I've been getting from child support. And I was going back to Australia, like, and getting the carer payment during some periods, not the whole time. But now I don't know what's happened to child support. I think the father's retired, and I'm guessing he's taken a lump sum payout and bye-bye child support. So, yeah, I still have like an amount that I've put aside that is just for putting into an investment for her, like a house or land or something like that, like we're in community, like a community project. This project is like, for me, looking at the building side, looking at the design side, like creating something that sits with my ethics, and also working alongside like a local organisation, Early Street Kids, which, my chicken shit's ready, which, yeah, for me is developing the relationships, like Freya can go next door and spend time with the kids there. I have help with her in the mornings, so I think this is her third week. Like, I was doing it by myself for a while, and oh my god, I was nearly losing it again. I just remembered how crazy I'd gotten in Australia, and I was actually on the verge of going, fuck, I don't know if I can do this. Like, I really just, you know, was having some doubts. And just thinking maybe I should just go back to Australia and put her into foster care, because, yeah, there's no way I'm fucking dealing with the NDIS again. And, yeah, I just didn't know what was kind of, how things were going to pan out. But I found a really great, amazing girl, Amelia, who's helping me in the mornings with her. And that really, 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 really helps, because you have no idea. After 15 years of repeating yourself again and again and again, having to, like, step her through every single step of everything, every day, every morning, every single time, like, that's just where I just can't do it anymore. It's like, that was the end of the other year. I was just like, that's it. Can't fucking do this shit anymore. I just can't do it. And so, yeah, I really do appreciate the help that I have had from the families that have helped us. And so so happy that we found Amelia. And, hey Amelia, you rock. And we're, yeah, just at the point at the moment where, obviously that, well, the carer payment stopped a couple of months ago. That only goes for like 6 weeks once you go out of the country. So, and then the child support stopped. So I thought maybe the father had taken a pension or something, so we should still get like a percentage. And like really for food and stuff, it's about $80 a week that I can live on here, and that's like with food, with getting our laundry done. Like we don't have nappies anymore, I can't get them sent here. I can't even navigate the NDIS portal. Like I've still got something like $86,000 of funding sitting in my NDIS thing, which actually will be over now, because that finished on the 24th or 26th of October. But I don't want to fucking go back into that situation and that environment and have to live that way. Like, that's fucking horrible. Like, it's another story. But anyway, so some of that money should have been for nappies. So basically the nappies that I brought here, I did pick up another box when we went out to get our social visa in Singapore. And when they ran out, that was it. So now we have a bit more washing. And here, like, it costs 80 cents a kilo. 70 or 80 cents a kilo for, you know, to get your clothes washed and everything. So I'm basically spending about $6 to $8 a week on laundry. And actually she's been good the last two or three nights. She hasn't went to bed at all. Like, and I think she realized like something. God. So with laundry, like my motorbike is like $2 to fill the tank. Food is like we can basically buy fresh vegetables and rice, everything like that, like maybe $4 to $6 a day for our food and fruit. Okay. And so then school fees, like I found an awesome school for her, Sunrise School, but it's the start. What's your school called, Frey? Starlight Anak. And it's and it's basically like a Steiner school, but for kids with disabilities. It's so beautiful. And yeah, actually through Putu next door at Valley Street Kids, they've got through 4 kids with disabilities there, I'd been to that school because they have like, it's all set up biodynamically, and it's a primary school primarily, and I'd been there to like, you know, buy sea salt and like vinegar and things like that, but I never knew they had a disability section. So now she goes there, and that costs $150 a month Australian. And then having Amelia, I just got her on a training thing at the moment, and we're going to do a few sessions with her. Because in that Sunrise School, they have a permanent OT there all the time. So she's, and they work on, their program is like basically integrating all the kids' needs together, and that's how they build their program. So yeah, it's beautiful. It's a bamboo building. They have a swimming pool, so she has lots of hydrotherapy. And yeah, just beautiful environment, beautiful feeling. She's just encouraged, you know, and more and more, she's joining in with the other kids again now. She's joining in with the Balinese dance, and yeah, like, super cool. So I'm really happy with her being there. So that's $150 a month, Amelia. is $60 a week, so about $240 a month. And I mean, yeah, in Australia, like, Amelia would be unaffordable. I mean, she comes at 6:30, 7 in the morning till about 8:30, helps Faye get ready for school Monday to Thursday, and then Friday, Saturday, Sunday she doesn't go to school, so she just helps me there in the morning till like a bit after lunch. So I'm slowly starting to feel my brain become a bit more, settled or starting to function again. That's when I just can't have that time to myself, like, the anxiety comes back. So, yeah. I'd like to be able to stay here and work basically on this project, like my future, what I want, what I'm passionate about is tiny houses, affordable housing, building with renewable materials, zero waste, like methane digester, you know, cooking from your shit, and grey water systems, so grey water gardening, so recycling water from your shower, kitchen, through like a natural plant filtration system, and then also growing your food in that, so saving water and producing food and stopping, like, you know, soaps and nutrients from being lost or, you know, going into rivers and stuff where it affects the wildlife, and of course water bricks. So, and that's what I want to do, that's what I want to work on. Like, I'm a massage therapist by trade and I love doing massage, but I just feel like I don't want to do it for money anymore. I just want that to be my gift that I can give people when I feel to. Like, yeah, I just got to the point where I couldn't, didn't want to massage anyone for money. I don't care about money. Could shove it up your ass. I only want to do what I feel to give and offer. So and I've always had an interest in design from when I was at university. In the first year with art and design, I designed actually a, I think it was bamboo, and I was looking at how to make a bamboo roof, like cutting the bamboo in half and how you'd sort of go like this with the bamboo, so it was like in a semicircle, so it would, you know, act as a roof and rain would run off and not leak, and community design, that sort of stuff. So that's basically what I want to do now. And sure, as like in future, like as in a business that I'll do for myself when I've learnt more about design and community and established this community, like I'll definitely like have some sort of spa or be working in natural natural therapy, healing. Like, I'd like Freya to be part of her daily schedule to be to do with community farming and harvesting like a flower or flowers. Like, they can, I imagine her with a group of other kids, you know, harvesting flowers and drying them, maybe mixing them with bath salts and making some little package things that we can put in a gift basket. And yeah, and I guess I'll be able to work in my business and that sort of thing. So and yeah, I guess take turns. Like, I still want to be involved in Freya's life. Like, I'd like to be, you know, I love gardening and all that too. I just can't handle being with her all the time, but I'm happy to supervise for, you know, a day or two half days a week with whatever activities, whether it's music or gardening, or probably not cooking because I'm not such a good cook. And so my aim is to work towards seeing that happen. And for me, this house is like a demonstration for the type of systems that I would expect to be a standard in a community that I'm part of. And I mean, I guess I haven't totally travelled everywhere and looked around, because it's a bit difficult to travel with. I mean, she loves travelling, but it's,
I don't know. I haven't
sort of joined another community. Special needs kids or anything like that. I would like to go to Camp Hill at some stage, but yeah, I guess I want to find other families that are interested, have a similar vision, and basically working on developing that with like local families, local landowners, and also volunteers and people who have skills, professional skills that are traveling, that would like to live as part of a community and be able to contribute, but also have time for themselves or their art or their career or passion, whatever they're doing. So, yeah, I guess I'm doing this crowdfunding for, I've got the crowdfunding for the bottle bricks, for the materials to make the grey water system and the methane digester. Crowdfunding or the workshop side of the project, so I'd like to have like some internship people come, and I worked out if I have four people paying $125 a week, that will cover like all the food and school fees as well. Anyway, I worked out it's like four people paying $125 a week to be on this build and learn about bamboo and everything. That includes all like food, transport, you know. Actually, we might have to buy a few more tools. Although, no, I've got three more knives coming from Java. That will basically help me to cover all the expenses I need to in terms of food, fuel, like living expenses, wages for these guys, but that doesn't account for Amelia and the school fees, so that's still the $240 and $1.5, so that's $400 a month, I think it's, and then with the other thing, electricity or car service, something like that, like it was $500 a month. So, yeah, and our social visa grows till February, so I'd like to be here in November, December, January, another 4 months, and then maybe we'll come back to Melbourne, I'm not sure. But, yeah, I mean, if I haven't got things set up by then, yeah, I guess it's going to be Melbourne and putting her in a care home or something. But if I can stay here with her, then of course I will. And she's quite happy here. I would like to spend sort of 6 months in Australia, 6 months here. Like, I'd like to establish something similar in Australia. Like, I see this whole project here as being like a demonstration that hopefully in the future in Australia we'll be able to establish something similar as well. So, to start with, it'll be like her family respite holiday. So basically families can buy into like a timeshare program where we have six groups of five families, because then for every group of five families there's a local family. So I want to support local businesses that will support what we're doing. I mean, we need infrastructure, so we need like, you know, laundry, transport, like people to help in the garden and supervise the garden, food growing, housekeeping, like carers as well, working with people with disabilities, and there's probably a couple of other ones. But so for every local family group that would like to work with us, then we can help provide establishment for a business, like probably like low or no interest loan for any like infrastructure that needs to set up. And then the idea is like to start with families come here 1 month a year, so their timeshare gets them 1 month per year, and then as time goes, like each year we build another house for in each group of family, and so by the end of, so 6 months of the year we've got the foreign international families coming, and then the other 6 months is sort of more for social projects, so we might have like a volunteer or an intern from somewhere come to do whatever in on a social visa, so whether it's helping train people with disabilities, helping teaching English, helping stuff to do with organic agriculture, stuff to do with helping train local people in whatever they would like to be trained in, whether it's social media or helping to market their businesses, whatever it is. And so the other six, or you know, like here in the orphanage, like they might have volunteers come when we're away, so they'll be welcome to stay in the house, and or other people that have helped on the build, and also the mob with Jukas, like who we work with a bit. They can also like use the house like their home too. So yeah, so then year by year we build more and more houses, like in a progression. So maybe the next year everyone gets to come and stay for 2 months, and next year 3 months a year, next year 4 months a year. So, and maybe people only want to come.